Pomona, who are 0-1 back in the series now, and that's a little bit surprising to some folks. Now, both of these teams were Titans coming into Game 1 here, and are Titans still coming into Game 2, let's not diminish them, as they both had 5-0 records. However, it looks like Utah is in a good position to continue their clean record coming into the round of 16 here, as they are 1-0 up on the series, and Pomona have to cling for dear life to this game number 2 and potentially draft number 2. What do you think we're going to see change, Deer Blaster, if anything?
Well, I mean, that LeBlanc will not be seeing a return here, so I feel like the adjustment that we will kind of have to see is a quote-unquote fallback for the Lamban onto something more, a bit more team-oriented. Ari is somebody that's on the rise. If he really does fancy another assassin, that is something that he has quite a bit of experience on.
Well, I mean, he was certainly potent on that assassin pick. I don't think the problem was the LeBlanc. The problem was that they learned how to deal with the LeBlanc, or at least hold it off, and that was everything that they had. That was everything that CPP had to throw at that game, because top lane really didn't happen. It was Maokai versus Nautilus. There wasn't really a lane. The jungles didn't break one way or another, and bottom lane was just so very heavily in favor of Jaymes and Toast that they were able to rally off of that to victory. Xerath.
Yeah.
That's some respect.
Yeah, absolutely. And I mean, even through the loss, with that skill that Balamban showed on the LeBlanc, that's banned away as well. Caitlyn also banned from Jaymes, so there's going to be quite a few adjustments here. Jhin has slipped through the cracks this time. And, I mean, comparing to last game, Malzahar also made it through. And Jace has also made it through this game as well. So there are quite a few champions that were taken off the table last time. They're going to be making it through off of Respect Bans, which Respect Bans are definitely good. And I'll be interested to see how Toast performs on this Malzahar, assuming is going into that support role. Of course, it's not really something that is played by Giraffe too much. Interesting to see. Kind of fallen out of favor at this point, but his mechanical Nami play last game was definitely something impressive.
Yeah, and as well as that, just the positioning that Toast had to keeping Jaymes alive was not a one-man show for sure that game. Jaymes did a great job of kiting backwards, but Toast also put in a lot of work with shields, heals, and CC. But that's the misfortune to counter out the potential Malzahar support we were talking about, which may actually flex it to the mid lane. That would be a decent way to answer that, as well as Jhin, the only one left of the Jhin Varus duo that's been dominating the meta that isn't banned out.
Yeah, it will be interesting to see Lethality Champion finally showing up here. And I mean, with Varus off the table, Jhin was basically guaranteed.
Since they were both banned out in game one.
Yeah. With Caitlyn off the table, though, I'm wondering if we'll see Jaymes step back onto that Ezreal. If we'll see him pull out something else. His most played is Ashe. Ezreal is definitely up there, even above his Caitlyn, in fact. But he also has some games on Vayne, Kog'Maw, and Sivir, all of which have been coming back in the meta. But we got double trees locked in here for Kal'Pahli.
You know, I really do like the Ashe here now, actually, because there's not that... There's only room now for one assassin, potentially, for, like, that Ahri or something along those lines. It's no longer, since they picked the Ivern, it's no longer the case where there's going to be a Rengar and a LeBlanc both leaping at you on an immobile AD carry. Pardon me. With Malzahar and Ashe, which is Ashe's ability to self-peel, I think she'd do just fine into the majority of the composition that we're already seeing here from CPP, but Sivir could be a good choice as well. Callista would be interesting. Would be certainly
definitely interesting.
Does provide some measure of utility. Callista's one of those semi-utility AD carries that you actually don't see in the current meta, partially because her numbers got kind of gutted last time Riot took a look at her. But
Ezreal, though,
final pick.
All right.
They don't really need utility coming out of the AD carry position. To be fair, they've got Hecarim, Nautilus, Orianna, and Malzahar. They've got a hell of a lot of utility already.
Yeah, what they're really looking for is someone that can really follow up on all of the engage that they're going to have here, because now they have three methods of engage with fantastic follow-up in the shockwave. If Nautilus catches any one person, if Hecarim catches any one person, if Malzahar catches any one person, that is suddenly a huge target that's going to get bursted by multiple other members locked down for a large amount of time, and they could even get huge multi-man engages off with this Hecarim and Nautilus, potentially, and then follow up with that shockwave. They need someone mobile like the Ezreal to be able to get in there and really deal the damage that they need in that ADC position, while also staying very safe against this Maokai and Ivern and Aurelion Sol and all of the damage and CC across the board from Cal Poly.
Well, one last note that I would like to hit before we head off is that we've got a few sponsors that I feel I should let you know about. As well as that, though, we are actually looking to hire here at the CSL. We're hiring a social media manager at the moment. So if you think you're right for that spot, head on over to our website at cstarleague.com for a little bit more information and see if you get the job. Go ahead and apply. However, our sponsors, starting at the top of the list, are In Order Band Gaming, which is a social app that allows you to set up group chats, group calls, calendar functions, scheduling, all that sort of thing, to wrangle your friends together for a game night, be that League of Legends, a tabletop game, whatever it is you want to do. We are also sponsored by the very platform that you're viewing and listening to this on, that is twitch.tv, who have been our sponsors for quite a while now and hopefully will be our sponsors for quite a while longer. Our final sponsor, though by no means the least, is Asus, who provide just magnificent, stellar hardware for your beast setup, be it for business, be it for gaming. That's really where they slate a bit more. You can get keyboards, mice, motherboards, whatever sort of pieces you need to put that beautiful machine together. Now, my name is Octavian. I am joined here by Blaster Boy, and this is the ULOL Campus Series round of 16. We're going to see you in just about a minute and a half once we get into game. Hello there, everybody. We are into game. My name is Octavian. I am joined here by Blaster Boy, and we're going to be getting in onto the Rift for the second in our best of three series here between University of Utah and CPP, standing for California Pomona Poly something that I'm forgetting? No!
Cal Poly Pomona.
Help me here. Cal Poly Pomona. Why am I just blanking on that name over and over? What's wrong with me? Don't answer
that. I don't know.
Don't answer that. I've known Blaster too long to want him to answer that question.
You got me there.
Now, Utah are 1-0 up, as you can see from our new fancy little thing in the corner there. That's graphical, technical term for it. And as such, are primed to keep their clean 5-0, after this, I suppose, 6-0 record in our little tournament here, in the little campus series. However, we'll see whether or not it can be dirtied up by CPP, as already Utah are playing slightly aggressively.
Yeah, already taking some hits in this bot lane, though. Gold advantage over to Cal Poly. 40 gold for this misfortune, actually.
Don't knock it.
I mean, Make It Rain doing big work there.
It's 4/10 of a health potion right there. I notice you're not laughing at my stellar jokes.
You wanna
work on that? You maybe make me look good on stream here, Blaster?
Maybe Boy some man other time.
Is actually going to be shoving out the lane really, really hard here, but taking something of a disfavorable trade with Giraffe. Giraffe is playing inside the Ring of Stars. However, the minions do discourage him from chasing any further, as does the lack of vision in the bush.
Really smart from Giraffe.
Yeah.
I think that's really smart from Giraffe, actually. If nothing else, I really like that sort of adjustment that he ended up making. So I might have to get back to that pretty quickly, as we're going to see an invade coming through here very, very soon. You're going to have to hold that thought, Kraiden.
Yeah, and Gifting is actually being helped by his friends of the forest here as they're aggressing onto the invader. Hecarim is going to be forced out of the jungle. Aurelion Sol actually taking a little jaunt out of the mid lane there, if you look at your minimap. But Blanbam not going to find anything for his efforts. And meanwhile, things are falling a different direction in the bottom lane. Noel Nuplox is not being bullied out there.
Yeah, and I mean, they have much more potential to get that lane pressure in this game than, as opposed to Malzahar Ezreal. There are definitely no pushovers, but as far as damaging minions in large quantities, Smith's Fortune definitely feels like a superior one with the Make It Rain, just damaging everything just a little bit. Oh, James, fancy feet, barely able to dodge away there. Really dangerous right now. To get to that point that I was going to make about the mid lane before, they're real, real, real quick. Most mid laners just kind of take that Aurelion Sol strategy lying down. They just don't really do anything about it. They don't go for a trade or anything. And if nothing else, I like the sort of deviation from the norm from Giraffe to walk in and try to take the fight to Bambalam so that he can't just really take that CS, take that farm, and take that huge push advantage that he gets in off of that level one. It's pretty typical to burn all of your mana with that W, level one as Aurelion Sol. And if it works out perfectly, a lot of mid laners will take that and then just immediately recall to get a few more potions, get a ward or something.
Look at how patient Gifting is being done.
Yeah.
He's been sitting in that tri-bush for a solid, like, 20 or 30 seconds. The land run down as well. Oh, James is caught.
It's James, uh-oh.
They don't go in on it, though. And Gifting, not choosing. I wonder what sort of opportunity he was waiting for, and if not exactly that, as Kraiden is going to find Blambam in the jungle. He smite onto the Raptors just to get a little bit of health back, but realizing Gifting was around the corner, Kraiden is actually going to take quite a bit of damage on the way out. It's first blood going over to the Celestial Dragon.
Flash away from Giraffe,
but he's going to be snared by the Deadly Flourish, and this is likely a pile of scrap where an Orianna once stood. Two kills going over to CPP.
Love that quick roam off of very little wave pressure from the side of Cal Poly down bottom, but they're still willing to step away and go for those kills and secure it onto Giraffe. Fantastic decision making from them, and very, very well communicated across the board. They pulled four members to ultimately get those two kills, so looking really good for Cal Poly all of a sudden in this game. They're looking quite a bit different. James, no!
Shift away.
Really
looks
close
like he'll be okay. Yeah, back under the safety of his turret. Does manage to dodge that crucial root cobble as well, meaning that he doesn't have to burn any summoners. And it's really always interesting to see a game, too, where laning advantage just in terms of champion matchup goes the other way in a given point.
Yeah.
Because you get to sort of be illuminated on whether or not it was down to player skill or down to the matchup. And in this situation, it seems like a mixture of both, as James has actually done a great job of holding his own in terms of CS. So he's not that far behind in gold, discounting the kill.
Through my work,
but he definitely has been bullied out of this lane over and over. That aspect, at least, was mostly down to the champion.
Yeah, the exactly where this wave control has gone, definitely down to champions here. Like I said, with Misfortune having that great level one push advantage and just being able to put so much pressure down by threatening with the damage and zoning off at the make it rain for about 2 seconds or so, 2.5, for the whole duration of that skill, regardless of how long exactly that is. There's just so much power there. And it's much more threatening than Malzahar at level 1 before he has... He needs at least 2 abilities to really be scary now, as his Voidlings don't pack too much punch anymore. And without Malefic Vision, good luck getting them to aggro onto anyone anyway. So...
They are stubborn little creatures. Crab back to the middle of their own.
But, I mean, to touch on that CS again, he's still keeping up. He's... just barely down at this point. He's going to be closing most of it here. Which, oh, Giraffe.
Splash, however, he does have a beautiful ult under the turret. Blamban pulled back in. And it's going to be basically a trade of ults there between the two mid laners. Though I suppose Ghost was actually burned.
Yeah, no summoners burned for Giraffe. I mean, he didn't have any to burn, but he didn't need to burn any of them there either. Good steal from this Ivern. Oh, but Kenya. No flash. Doubles to the Nautilus.
Not ideal for that to go to the Nautilus, actually. Especially considering that Giraffe is in something of a hole right now in the mid lane. But an assist nonetheless is still useful.
On one hand, I definitely agree. It would have been much more effective going over to the Ori, but on the other, if something can disrupt this top lane matchup from just being completely stagnant, then that could be really big, because either of these top laners will be hugely important as this match goes on, and you're kind of expected to just go pretty much dead even in a Maokai versus Nautilus matchup either way. So the fact that this can tilt for a little bit results in a bit of a farm lead, maybe even a kill potentially for once in this solo kill between Nautilus Maokai. That can shake things up quite a bit.
As we've got more action in the bottom lane, there's a level advantage for the little Nuke. He does have level 6 before his counterpart does. However, it looks like they don't have an opening. And Gifting continues this highly aggressive Ivern play. In fact, the reason that he went down once was because he was caught up going for him.
Yeah.
He spent, I'd say, like an equal amount of time in the enemy jungle as his own.
Ooh, yeah, very close here now. A bit of a pincer coming through from
serious case of
Utah. Utah.
This is exactly what happened for First Blood this time.
Ooh, Giraffe, though. Pulling out the combo.
Doesn't have a lot of damage, though, at the moment. He's just rocking some Dorn's Rings and a bit of mana, so... Really didn't have what it took to go for that fight, and ends up dying in the 1v1.
And again, very little pressure in this bottom lane, but the Jhin MF roam. They roam out, they leave. Step away looking for damage on this mid turret, and they very well may get it. They're losing farm. They need to get this turret to really make it worth it. And it looks like they have it. So that's a great move for Cal Poly. Sacrificing a little bit of farm on their ADC, they're still pretty much dead even, and they walk away with a big gold lead.
Cal Poly certainly have a steadfast grip on the early game, though to be fair, last game as well didn't look too bad for them starting off.
Yeah.
However, where the biggest difference between the two games is in this bottom lane, where now the advantage is arguably the gold bags here over to Lone Noob, who does have about a 500 gold swing. So very different from last time around. And a lot of Yu's ability to win the first game was in playing around that cave line. So I'm worried for their ability to come back into game 2 here.
Yeah, a lot of it's going to be dependent on when this Ezreal really hits his spikes. If he's keeping up very well in CS, even has a bit of an advantage, they need to be getting out of dodge here.
Cult comes down, one block the spell immunity from Elspeth.
Oh, double TP.
Yeah, this is the double TP comp in full effect. Gifting going to be sent straight to the void with the Malzahar ulti to get him there. However, Giraffe takes a big crit on the way out and restructures, happily able to tank up a bunch of damage. Kraiden now roam to the bottom side. This is a full-on 5v5 between these two teams. Restructure brings down the Ezreal. It's a double kill to the Maokai as bullet time comes through. Giraffe flashing away, but still
caught
in the deadly flurry. Shockwave gets flashed as well. A few more summoners to add to the fire, but in the end, it's a 2-for-1 trade, and potentially now a shove onto the turret. Or a dragon tank. We'll see where they go.
Yeah. Really, really strange from Utah. They thought they had that. Uh oh.
Kraiden goes down, Blambam's on a killing spree, Celestial Expansion, getting the range he needed.
And I thought it was over there, but they just go for everything that they could possibly reach for. Cal Poly. Look like a very different team, really. They're making so much more punctual plays than last time. Even when Cal Poly looked solid in the early game last time, Utah looked really good too. Utah equally was matching them. They were ahead in turrets from smarter rotations. Cal Poly was there to stop them in some situations, particularly around that top side, but that's just non-existent here. As even with the quicker roams, Utah is just a bit behind in gold at this point. A significantly larger lead for Cal Poly this game than we ever saw from Utah last. 4,000 gold, 5,000 nearly. At only 11 minutes in, that's the first dragon over to them as well.
And I feel like a really big deal for part of what makes this game as different from game one as it is the fact that Gifting has spent so much more time towards the bottom side of the map and also in the enemy jungle. This Ivern play has been so incredibly aggressive. Yeah, he doesn't have the best scoreline to back it up, but the amount of pressure that he's applied to the bottom lane, which already was at a deficit just because of the champion matchup, has resulted in Lol Noob blocks being kind of really incredibly far ahead, and Blambam getting a lot of opportunistic gold out of it, picking off kills in the jungle, roaming to the bottom lane, doing what Aurelion Sol really does best, roaming around the map really quickly and helping out the rest of his team.
Yeah, and we're seeing this gold continue to pick up Cal Poly as these aggressive plays are made, because these aggressive plays, while they are kind of crazy to some extent, for sure, they're communicating them very well. They're taking the steps required. And I'm actually really surprised to see an Ivern in such a carry meta with both Rengar and Kha'Zix on the table still. Oh, James.
Dead Ezreal, voice of light. Ghost is likely to fall as well. Just one more
Shockwave.
Take off that passive would have done it, but yeah, Shockwave pulling two back under the turret as Gifting nearly goes down, but the draft's auto isn't enough, even following through that flash. And there's tanks fighting, I guess. Okay.
The last bit of excitement we're going to see from that engage, I suppose, is Nautilus and Maokai butting head with some farm, but now, even though it was a 1-for-0, the number of members that were pushed all the way back to base from the damage of Cal Poly still means that they get a turret in the end.
And what do you do? What's your way back in the match here? They've got this... They've still got such a utility-heavy team comp that I feel like they're not shut out by any means, but it's certainly going to be a rough road back.
Yeah, it definitely is. I mean, this sounds like a kind of a solo queue thing to say, as like, hey, don't surrender yet, guys. We have late game. They do have late game. That is simply a fact that Ezreal and Ori will scale very well into late game. Unfortunately, the issue that they're going to run into is that Aurelion Sol and Jhin also scale very well into late game. Although Aurelion Sol is very difficult to play in late game team fights, as his positioning is very, very strange and very specific.
Not have faith in the master level 4.
I mean,
look, the guy has played
at least
24 games.
He's already died once, so. This is automatically not as good as the LeBlanc from him last game. Giraffe taking a bit of damage, but not too much in the end. But basically, they need this Ezreal to come into his own, really, and It doesn't look like that's going to be happening anytime nice soon here.
Positioning from Balamban. He landed every single tick of his passive there, matching perfectly James's movement.
Yeah. So, and another good roam from Miss Ivor. Now, pushing in mid is going to be kind of sketchy. That's a little bit aggressive.
We're picking up multiple ults. Hold back.
Well, that's what they need.
On. There's Kenya landing the hook as well. Gifting is likely out of the picture. Exhaust a little bit too late onto the Hecarim, and he can chase in onto the Djinn, and that could be Lolnude going down, but he's got 50 health, and he makes it out the back of the fight. Meanwhile, though, the rest of his team is starting to fall around him, and this is the first really solid team fight that we've seen.
Oh, Ezreal
ult! Ezreal ult takes the kill! Off to the left of the screen there, James landing the snipe, and we'll see whether or not the structure inevitably does get chased down. And there's a red buff or a round chasing. Down for the count, just a matter of time.
That is...
Voidlings pick a bit of a... A fight with a little bit of a larger crab over there. Rift Herald wins between two Voidlings and a Rift Herald. I put my money on that.
Oh yeah, definitely. Every time. Should be one-shotting those Voidlings. Shockwave near the upper giraffe. He's got some pressure here. Oh, missed Voice of Light.
Oh. One more Q lands on Blamban, and it looks like he won't be able to claim any kills, but... They won't bring him down either. A good fight for Utah. And I think that's the first time in this game that I can say that.
Yeah, absolutely. They played that really, really well. They punished perfectly on the overstep from Balamban. I can't say his name right very quickly. Balamban.
He loses that's giant stacks for it.
There we go. Yeah, he's fallen from 6 to 2 now. So, I mean, that's definitely not going to be doing him any favors, because all of that damage that we saw before, which honestly wasn't really that impressive because he was lacking stacks on the Machias. He's gone for his Negatron to start off his Abyssal as his third item, it seems. He's not the most damage-packed champion on the map, and this Machias is not going to be doing him favors down all the way at 2 stacks. It was just barely gold efficient before. It was a little bit profitable even, but now it's just in the negative for him. It's 5 stacks to break even, stat-wise, with the cost of that item, by the way, for anyone unaware. This dragon, though, will be securely in the grip of Cal Poly.
There's not much of a reason to take the risk of contesting that Airdrake, and Kenya's at least going to be able to trade it out for top lane under turret, so... I think Utah's perfectly happy to give that one up.
Yep.
Movement speed over to him already pretty quick on his wings. Can't really say quick on his feet. Aurelion Soul. could actually be pretty powerful, but trading it for the turret.
Yeah, totally fine trade for them. They're happy to do that.
Blam again, biting off more than he can chew, and that's difficult to do when you're a dragon. Down goes the Aurelion.
Yeah, and that is not good at all for Cal Poly. All of a sudden, they're missing a huge chunk of their wave clear, and they're the ones on the back foot. Not only did that pick shut down a lot of their defense of this mid lane just as a composition, but they're also having to all of a sudden respond to what Utah is doing. Just off of that one pick, there was no one else here. Now everyone has to pull together, and this is a 4v5 attempted defense, and the turret's going to get crushed, no issue.
I don't think Utah should pick this fight here. This is getting dangerous.
It's incredibly risky.
Balamban has Ghost, double Airdrake, and Comet of Legend to get back into that fight.
Yeah.
So I think it's the right call to back off, but they get an outer turret, they get another kill. Utah are just definitively back into this game now. They're only about 1,000 behind.
And I think while... Cal Poly seemed like they were pretty much okay with the turret. I'm not sure if they really should have been in the end, because this gold lead is slipping. Obviously, they can't see that. And to them, they were still up 2 more turrets. They felt like they probably had much more of a gold lead, but the reality of it is they're around 1 turret behind. They're only about 1 turret ahead now. And I mean, that's the difference in the scoreline. All of a sudden, Utah just springing to life, and this composition is coming into its own. We're seeing this Ezreal going for that more damage-focused build. Trinity Forces coming up next is nearly completed. 2 components. He'll have that very soon. If we look at his gold, he's at 300. He's about halfway there. This Orianna is getting stronger and stronger and prioritizing damage. He went Morello's into the Blasting Wand. As opposed to Balamban,
who... James might be in control, but he is very slippery. There's a teleport actually coming in.
That's double teleport. Out.
Double teleport, triple teleport, one from the other team as well. But I imagine that one gets canceled, yeah. Maokai not wanting to join the fight, not that far forwards. And actually, this is a really nice fight for Utah to pick if they can just get in onto it now, because it would be a 4v5, but they at least pull some summoners.
Yeah, flash for flash between the top laner, Kenya, and Balamban. Oh, Toast in the wrong neighborhood, though. This could be real bad.
Yeah, spell immunity actually popped there by Gifting's auto attack out of the bush. That extra range from an Ivern in a bush. Deadly. And that's a pick onto the Malzahar. A pretty key portion of the composition, actually. That's how they've gotten both picks onto Balamban in the last two fights. And just hitting him with the purple laser from the face. Now, death timers aren't that long just yet, and they've got some good defense under turret, so they may not actually have to give up anything like that.
Yeah. Oh, shockwave.
That's pretty big.
Yeah, but I think he can just walk off.
Stun on the Kraiden. This is going to be difficult to walk off. Ekra multi pulled back, and they may have to give up the turret now. The Malzahar is back with us on the rip. Ezreal ulti comes through the wave. Command attack lands, but Giraffe is caught in the wrong spot. Redemption, actually. Is he going to pop him? Nope, he's okay. There's the ulti onto Restructure. Maybe not exactly the target they wanted, but Kenya is in the back line doing some disrupting. If James can just get in there and do some good damage, then maybe we'll see at least one kill to go back over to Utah. Looks like it'll be the Maokai that they chop down. But one kill traded back for the turret is just fine for Cal Poly.
They even made it two. They got Balambam in there somewhere as well.
I
didn't see. I completely missed where he died as well, but somewhere in between. They do get another kill, so 2-0 off the back of a lost turret. They'll take it every day of the week, and now they're on to the Baron. Levels are dead even. This is 50-50. Really scary. Really scary.
Just so very risky, but maybe Utah need to take some risks to fully reclaim control of this game, and that's Nautilus actually claiming the kill there, as James is dangerously holding off the other team.
Oh, shockwave.
Stun from Blandman. From Blandman, right? And the Celestial Expansion. I think, yeah, Kenya needs to be the sacrificial land here. He has to peel off, hold the enemy away. Maybe he goes down, maybe he doesn't. One way or another, though, he does sacrifice himself for the team. Maybe, there's still too many shields. He's not getting
it. Worth a shot. That looked like a very juicy MF right in his face.
Still, though, but I feel like that's just fine. He peeled off, he knew what he was doing in the end. And they claimed the Baron. So he was even the one to hit the Baron. He even got the accolades of being the one to last hit the objective.
And I mean, while that death there isn't great, losing the Baron buff, Dragon coming up soon, he is still going to be up in time. He's going to be a few seconds late, but not really all that much. It's maybe at this point with home guards past 20 minutes. He'll maybe be like 5-10 seconds late to the dragon spawning, and this can absolutely be stalled out from the start from the side of Utah. And James is huge here because he just hit his Trinity Force. He also hit his Mirror Mana. This is a massive power spike even from the last fight. He didn't have either of these when he got those kills just a few minutes ago.
Speaking of so choices, though, I would like just to take a moment here to recognize the fact that Abyssal wasn't actually completed by
the game. Interesting.
It is quite
and engage.
And Voice of Light actually going quite a bit.
Shockwave!
The multi plus the shockwave ball delivered to the back lines. James brings down his Gifting and is starting to do some damn good consistent damage. However, he does have to shift back out of the fight. Jamhart's trying to chase down a few kills, but he's going to get evaporated by the Ezreal damage. And now it's carries v carries. As Giraffe flashes forward for the command attack, the dissonance doesn't connect though, so the slow does not land. However, another command attack, plus a kill.
Oh,
max
man.
Range, well done by James. And they'll steal a little cube up.
Potentially. So close to death there again, but he's able to kite it out, and this is definitely looking like a dragon. Balamban is not going to be able to get in here in time, not even worth the risk.
And
you just get taken out of the sky all
they
too
have
easy.
Control of the game again.
Yeah, this all
seems
of
to be
a sudden.
Maybe a Utah special. Give up
maybe
laning phase control. Not too much, just a little bit. You know, like worry everybody during laning phase, and then get a Baron. Just, you know, there's no step two between that. Step one, don't win laning phase. Step two, get Baron.
Yeah.
That's the whole plan.
Mm-hmm. Basically, I mean, it has. The only thing is that if Utah is showing off here, and they are actually really strong in laning, and they can perform well individually,
I don't doubt that they can perform in lane. Don't twist my words. Yeah. I doubt that they're, like, purposely throwing, as the implication goes.
I would certainly hope not, but if they are, then they have a much higher chance of going very far in the Yule Law Campus series here. If they are not, and this is actually how they tend to play, and this is a strategy that they prefer to go for, lose lanes, then win the game. That's so risky, but here's an engage right now. Gotta get back to that.
Exhaust on the Kraden. And that's one summoner pulled. Nautilus looking for an engage. Yeah. Restructure's the only one they find, but they're more than willing to try and cut down the Maokai. Whether or not that pays off for them, as James and Giraffe get caught in the misfortune, ulti support or not, that hurts. And that is Cal Poly fighting back.
What a beautiful combo. Big stun toast going to burn.
Deathfire? Away. No, it takes away. There's a health potion involved as well, but a flash from Balamba. It's okay. Malzahar's gone.
And now Balamba's up to 20 stacks again.
Oh boy.
Out of nowhere. Falling back on this Majai's. Oh man. Cal Poly. That was a perfect fight from them there. The Star Surge was so well placed from Blam Bam onto multiple carries. Perfectly layered with that bullet time. Just absolutely crushing the health bars of Utah. And now this game on its head again. 2,000 in the bank for Cal Poly off the back of that.
And I have to question whether or not it was the right call to soak so much damage and so many cooldowns into the Maokai at the start of that fight. They once again, Toast dropped his ulti onto Restructure. It does do percentage damage, so it's actually not that bad at burning away a tank. But Restructure was able to get out of there just fine, and they had grouped themselves up perfectly for Jamhearts' ulti.
Yeah, if you're going to do that, I think in general the idea is okay. Because best case scenario, you get a kill onto the tank for free, because and nobody's going to help him, because who's going to fall back and peel for the tank, especially when there's an MF support? There is no one else in this lineup that is willing to step backwards to save the tank's life. They're not going to jump in with CC and be all heroic like a tank would for a carry. That's not going to happen. But you have to respect what's going on around you. And that just simply did not happen for Utah in that case. They burned so many cooldowns onto the Maokai, didn't kill him, and then also got caught off guard by the rest of Cal Poly delivering damage in CC around the fight. Now Giraffe, no!
Stepping up to try and auto that turret, he goes just a little too close. He pays the ultimate price. Now Kenyon's going to be eventually melted down as the rest of his team is being chased away behind him. Blandman, though, taking up the front lines. Malzahar ulti to the base, and James is doing some work. He hasn't really been touched yet. Voice of Light is the only thing to land any sort of damage onto him, but the rest of his team has fallen. Now shifting away over the wall, Blandman gonna follow him with the Common Legend. Yeah. The stun as well. Some star stuff finds its way into his face. follows! It's a quadra kill for the Djinn! That could be GG. We could be going to game three.
Yeah, this is looking like a game three to me, Ox.
I'm excited.
Giraffe is up in 5 with Shockwave. Could turn on its head in an instant.
We'll see.
The potential is there, though. He has the damage for it. He just needs to deliver. He's got to be careful of when he burns it. Got to respect Restructure.
That's a 2-man Shockwave onto both carries. He does manage to finish off the Djinn. They don't have a lot more damage to take down these turrets with.
It's not over yet. If they can pick up kills off the back of this, that's fantastic, but even if they can't, Utah still have some life left in them. Minute on this dragon, Baron is alive. There's bigger fish to fry right now for Utah than merely surviving. They've got to be able to push out of their base if they want any hope left in this game with only one, and a damaged one at that, Nexus turret.
Yeah. Baron is going to be crucial, I think, over the next 5 minutes at most, because that's how long I see this game lasting, maybe. James as well is going to be equally crucial. Baron will be where the fight happens, and James will be the man to decide it, I think, because he's been outputting so much damage in these last few team fights. That last one, he was doing a good job of cutting backwards, but his team just fell apart a bit too quickly, and of course, not having an Orianna to ult since Giraffe got picked off at the very start of the engagement really hurt their team fight.
Now, he has that Blade of the Rune King completed. Not entirely sure if he had that in the last fight or not. If not, then that's a pretty big spike. Still, some more damage to come from James in this game. He's still got a ways to go. Picking up that Executioner's going into this fight is going to be pretty significant. Hurting the healing of that Ivern and the Maokai built-in healing as well is going to be pretty big. But right now, neither of these teams are really willing to do anything. Cal Poly is looking for a pick, but Utah is just waiting for this Nautilus to be able to really get some work done, and he wants to move up without teleporting if he can.
Well, Noob's going to pull the trigger. A lot of damage onto James. That is exactly the target they need to hit. Toast now slowed up as well. Not slowed up as much as he might have been last pack.
Whoa.
50% slow now on Jhin
ulti. I don't know about dropping Voice of Light on to the Malzahar, because he just walks out no problem.
Do you have a spectator glitch right now?
Yeah.
As well? This has been happening, actually, the last few days of my casting gigs. The spectator client's just been not enjoying the last update from Riot. Apologies to everybody watching right now. Usually it resolves within a few seconds. I think it's down to the fact that the players pause the game, but the spectator client just doesn't get that information, so we don't actually see a pause screen. The game just kind of stops. So probably, yep there we go. Probably
there it
just
is.
A small issue on one side or another, something with an internet connectivity problem, maybe. We should be getting back into the game very shortly. It's really just
now,
that the pause UI doesn't.
Now this fight coming through. And Kenya has arrived, teleported in. Bit caught out though, has to step
Kenya,
away.
More like, Kenya, kill me. This man is a mega tank. They cannot touch his health. Maybe they can, eventually. Eventually he might go down. Kraiden, though, is a bit less tanky than his friend from the top lane, and he will fall in the end. As Kenya continues to try and feel back for his team. Balamban is the one going to be shut down here now, though, as Utah turn and bite back a little bit. The flash forward from Kenya. Restructure will fall. There we go. Restructure will fall.
Took him a little bit, but he got
there. Utah.
All of a sudden, this inhib has respawned, and Utah looking very good. It was kind of a sketchy fight at first, but in the end, they take it in their favor. They've got to get vision control off of these kills, though. Yeah. They can save their inhib, that's great. They can get the dragon, fantastic. But they need vision control around this Baron, because right now, they have nothing. And Cal Poly has everything covered, every corner. They have, like, if you just look over at the at formerly known as Banana Brush, there are like three wards right there. It's James, yeah, taking a big risk. You're going for this dragon.
Yeah, he just got to shift over. Does he have the mana?
Oh.
Yeah, he
does. Yep,
the dragon gets stolen away. I mean,
unfortunately.
Shifting has smoke.
Yeah. He was hoping that nobody would go and check. Unfortunately, not the case. Dragon down Elder is the next one up on the table, though. That's the fourth elemental of the game. They're to Cal Poly, so looking very good for them there in that metric, for sure.
Speaking of metrics and numbers that might go up, Valentine has one key for him. He's curiously sold that with that Soul Stealer. Huge, but a four. No, yeah, a four, man. Shockwave from Giraffe pulls back so hard for the side of Utah to shut down to the Maokai, though. Lone Noob blocks claims one as well. And they just don't have enough. Maybe if that Ezreal had been farther back in the fight and had been alive for that four-man Orianna ult, that could have been Utah just claiming this game once again. But sadly, that wasn't the case. And it looks like we might actually be going to game three here, though. They don't have a minion wave, so maybe I speak too soon. Destruction can tank this for a bit, though. Especially with Redemption.
Surprise!
have you with me, Blaster?
Yeah, sorry about that. Oh man, Cal Poly. Yeah, crushing fight there. Really? Oh. Yeah, I don't think James is going to be able to save us here.
They're going to the back lines.
This could be.
200 health left on the Nexus. It's a double kill. No. He has real just as the game ends. We will go to game three. That one was certainly neck and neck, though. And oddly enough, the team with the giraffe didn't win. Anyways, one last horrible pun before we go into a break aside. We're going to play a short commercial before we get into game three. It was just a few minutes, everybody, and we'll be right back.
Ben, Sam, and Ken are on separate journeys to defeat the menacing vile dragon. But let's just say luck isn't on their side. If only there was a way for them to find each other and band together. Well, that's why there's Band. It's a mobile app that allows people to come together using common interests. With Band, you can find fellow gamers, chat, schedule gaming sessions, and conduct polls. Stage epic battles with friends while sharing videos and photos along the way. So try Band today. Band. Be together.